Members of City Council, please attend the call meeting of the City Council to be held in the sixth floor conference room, 801 Crawford Street, 5 p.m. Tuesday, July 12, 2016, for the purpose of a public work session. In addition, you may consider a motion to go into closed meeting by order of the mayor. Mr. Cherry?
Here.
Dr. Ennis?
Here.
Mr. Meeks? Mr. Moody? Ms. Simmons?
Here.
Dr. Whitaker?
Present.
Mayor Wright?
Here.
Dr. Patton?
Yes. Mayor, Vice Mayor, and members of City Council, during this evening's public work session, we have three presentations. Our first presentation is a proposed cultural arts district for the downtown corridor. Over the past 18 months, the Museum and Fine Arts Commission has worked diligently on the development of a cultural arts district concept. The Museum and Fine Arts Commission believe there is a need to establish an identity for Portsmouth as a city of arts and culture. There is an opportunity to maintain and leverage the many assets of Portsmouth for its residents and visitors as well. And there is an opportunity to increase diversity, diversify, and strengthen cultural offerings for local citizens as well as attract new audiences. Mrs. Nancy Perry, Director of Museums, will make the presentation. Our second presentation is an overview of the city's information technology and infrastructure services and programs. As you know, information technology is the use of systems for storing, retrieving, and sending information. Mr. Daniel Jones, the Director of Information Technology, will share in his presentation how IT is used in all facets of operation of daily municipal government delivery of services to our citizens. Let us also be reminded that much of what people use in the 21st century was created with help from information technology. The third presentation and final for this evening is an update on the 801 Water Street building that was slated by the past administration as a turnkey building for public safety. This evening, Mr. James Wright, City Engineer, will provide an update on this building evaluation by Clark and Nexum with recommendations for further consideration for a public safety facility. We will start with Mrs. Perry.
Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of City Council, and Dr. Patton, thank you for allowing me to present the proposal for the Cultural Arts District for Portsmouth that has been developed by the Museum and Fine Arts Commission. Two of the commissioners are here now, Sandra Boone and Karen Burgess. Karen Burgess and the late Leslie Parker were the ones that spearheaded this planning process. Members of the Commission have spent time hosting meetings and presentations on this concept to civic leagues, service leagues, business organizations, artists, and other individuals. For the district to be successful, this type of community and business engagement is essential. So tonight we're going to define a cultural arts district and talk a little bit about our vision and goals. So what is a cultural arts district? Quite simply, we feel it's downtown Portsmouth. We feel that downtown Portsmouth already is a cultural arts district in everything but a designation. So a cultural arts district is a demarcated urban area intended to create a critical mass of places of cultural consumption, such as, and these are all things that we already have, art galleries, theaters, music venues, historic sites, faith organizations, neighborhoods, public art, business district, educational facilities, museums, farmers market, and festivals. Arts districts typically coincide with or complement other efforts such as tourism, downtown revitalization, small business growth, and nightlife or social scene development. The vision is for the proposed boundaries is to go from High Street, from Effingham to the Seawall, north to Queen. It would include Portside, south to King, Portsmouth Pavilion, and Festival Park. And then you have a map, and the map shows you things that are already in the proposed cultural arts district, as well as some other attractions just adjacent to the cultural arts district, such as Old Town. The path of history runs through downtown and out into Old Town, and it's anchored by two parks, Fort Nelson Park and Gosport Park. We're looking at cultural arts branding for the designated area, gateways such as signage at the two entry points, banners along High Street, and looking at developing a website. The overall goals, we would continue to engage the community as we worked on the plan and implementation strategies. We would encourage diversity. We would like to establish business and arts partnerships, enhance and support tourism, support existing businesses, support business development, and support residential development. The city benefits. Leverages the community's current network of attractions and venues, promotes residential development, attracts diverse businesses, enhances and supports tourism, supports culture as an engine for attracting and retaining young professionals. In addition, the goal is to have property tax values improved, increase tax revenues, and staying relevant in this competitive market. The next steps. We would like the City Council to approve the concept of a cultural arts district. Prior to 2009, any community that wanted to establish a cultural arts district had to have the approval of the General Assembly. State lawmakers began allowing any Virginia locality to create an arts district and offer incentives or unique flexible rules for creative or arts-related businesses in 2009, and this is the state code that's applicable for that. We would like to look at including the arts and cultural information and a link on the city's website and work on the development of a cultural arts district plan and implementation strategies, which we would bring back to City Council at a later date for approval. Any questions?
Yeah, let me, first of all, thanks, Nancy, for everything that you do. And just give me a visual, if you could, of what you'd like to see this district look like in 4 or 5 years. Are you thinking the New Orleans type? There's always something. I know that's the mother of all of them, but there's always something on every corner. There's a band. There's some type of venue where there's playwriting and all of that type of thing going on every night during the week.
No, we're not looking. I think that might be further down than
right.
Than
what are we looking at?
Five,
to kind of get
than
it?
5 or 10 years. We're really hoping that individuals or small entrepreneurs would come in and take up some of the storefront space that we have. There's living, working and living opportunities in the downtown corridor as well. Williamsburg has established a cultural arts district, and one of the things they found that they lacked was their zoning in that district didn't allow for people to live and work in the same space. And we already, working with planning, we already have that zoning that people can live and work in the same place. So it's looking at trying to infill some of the storefronts that are there. Amazingly, with the events that we have presently, whether it's city-sponsored, city-co-sponsored, or sponsored like Gosporama by a separate organization in the museums, we probably are bringing way over 300,000 plus to the downtown corridor already. So it's building on what we have. It's really working to identify and brand us as a cultural arts district. Right now, it's hard to find everything that's going on. It's located in several sites. And if you look at what's going on throughout the state, you can easily Google cultural arts districts and they pop up. So people that are looking for that kind of environment to stay in a bed and breakfast, to be able to walk, go to the movies, go to a concert, go to a museum, that's what they're Googling. And we're missing out on that kind of tourism. So over the years, we'd like to, the goal would be to build on the really strong festivals that we have, look at adding other activities and festivals, not necessarily the city sponsoring them, but working with other organizations to do that. Continuing to promote public art, not just in the downtown corridor, but throughout Portsmouth.
But with us officially establishing a district, what benefit would that be to entice someone to want to come and live in that district or open up a business? Because they can do that now. Everything you just said, we can do right now, other than get populated on a website under an art district. So,
According to the state code, it allows the city council to provide some other incentives if you decided to do that down the road to encourage young entrepreneurs to come to downtown, to attract them to come to downtown Portsmouth. So it allows some incentives that we haven't talked about or haven't really thought of at this point, but it does allow flexibility according to the state code for city council to do some of those things.
Mayor. And lastly, how long have your committee been working on this?
18. They have been working at least 18 months.
18.
And it was spearheaded, as I said, by Karen Burgess and the late Leslie Parker. And then the whole commission has been working on doing brainstorming sessions, meeting with other groups, and brainstorming going out into the community. They've talked to artists, individuals, civics groups, service organizations, held various community meetings to get input. And so the concept has changed a little bit with each community engagement.
I was going to share that designating as a cultural arts district strengthens proposals when you are writing proposals for funding, grants, foundations. And as Mrs. Perry said, it's a wave that's going across the country. And I have put Mrs. Perry in touch with Dr. David Bickman, who's been working with municipalities, universities. I worked with him at the university as it pertains to grants through cultural arts districts. So it would definitely strengthen our opportunities of getting more funding for art, artists, and things like that.
Any other questions? Yeah, Dr. Wood.
Yes. Would this also entail a increased marketing for the cultural arts district, that it would be more publicity promoting the district and the activities within the district?
That would be something we put in our strategic plan and implementation strategies to come back to City Council to review and approve. LaVarce, did you want to add anything on that?
Yes. Dr. Whitaker, just like Norfolk created the Neon District in the downtown area, they have been able to leverage a lot of support from the Neon District in terms of their advertising and their funding, in terms of sponsorships from private companies, as well as, like you said, grants writing. So us having an arts district in downtown Portsmouth, it will help us in the region, because now that an urban downtown in Norfolk has one, you know, if we establish ours, it'll help to leverage some of that support and get sponsorship dollars that we can't get now.
And unlike some of the districts that have to build from the ground up, we have such a rich downtown corridor with all the things that were listed up there, that we're not starting from the ground up. We really have a leg up in how we, and it's really in how we present it and market it and package it for the future.
And under the code, you mentioned that there were incentives that the council could eventually receive. Would those incentives also help build up some of the businesses within the district that are presently there?
Well, it's not that you would receive them, it's that you could grant them to the businesses.
Right, that are presently there and that are located in the district.
Yes, yes.
Dwight.
Yes.
Well, if that's the case, then I would hope that the Portsmouth Community Library would be included in that district, because mentioned increased marketing, incentive opportunities, publicity, mm-hmm. and to exclude that museum, I don't know what other.
Oh no, it wasn't. It's not in the district. It's part of the plan of things that are adjacent. So it's the community library. It's the Jewish Cultural Center. It's the Railroad Museum. It's AME Church. They're adjacent to Gosport Park and Fort Nelson Park. So while there's a designated district, the richness of what we have to offer goes beyond that, and they're in the adjacent. So we package them all together. But as far as incentives, it would be in that.
Right. So
in that district.
So for example, the Jewish Museum you're speaking of, you know, Effingham, mm-hmm. that's not in the district.
No, it's not in the district. There's things that are adjacent to the district, and some of it has to do
with the streets
zoning,
of the district.
And we wanted to look at, I'm not sure the right word, Bob, but we wanted to look at establishing the district where there zoning codes allowed it, and then move from there. It doesn't, this isn't a set boundary.
So establishing from King to Queen on either side of High Street would be, if we were to incentivize a business or someone, anyone moving in that district would be able to get those incentives. But when we talk about the cultural arts district,
community,
we include all of those things on the outskirts of that.
Right.
We would include
advertising.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Yes. Right. And at any time, we could expand it.
Mm-hmm.
But we have to start
somewhere.
Okay. But all the other things that help make Portsmouth attractive for people would be all included in how we promote it.
So there's no code limitation as to the area of your cultural art district?
No.
So why not include those museums instead of making them adjacent, since this is what we're doing? Why not include them in the initial design?
Just as long as, can we do that?
Good evening. Oh, no problem. Yeah, this under the state code is separate from the requirements under zoning, and the city council has broad authority to establish the district where you choose to establish it. And then the incentives that get built in there, there's tax relief, there's permit reductions, there's a number of things that the state code would allow you to look at. You're not required to do any of them, but you could look at a package of incentives to try and encourage businesses to locate in that area. So there is no prohibition about expanding. I think the only thing you'd want to look at is making sure it's compact enough to market it so it doesn't look too over bloated, so to speak. But there's certainly no state mandated restriction on doing that.
I would think that if we're going to have certain museums within the cultural district, it should be inclusive.
Sure.
And,
yeah,
so
that's fine.
Like north and south. Wouldn't that do it? North Street and South Street instead of King and Queen?
Sure, yeah.
It would?
Mm-hmm. No,
sure.
It won't. It won't take the community library.
No, it's doing.
Well, yeah, it will.
Yes, it will.
Yes, it would.
Yeah. South Street's on the
north.
Yeah.
North to south instead of north to Queen.
Yeah, North Street instead of Queen Street and South Street instead of King Street.
Sure, sure.
Doesn't that do it?
Mm-hmm.
North to South Street.
As long as
North
it incorporates.
That's what I'm saying.
It incorporates all of the museums.
Sure. That would. Yes, sir, it would.
Now, what was your rationale for going from King to Queen? Was there one that, I mean, you've been at this 18 months, I'm sure you have. We don't want to, in 5 minutes, I like what the suggestion, what Dr. Whitaker, the vice mayor said, but was there something that you were trying to target doing that? Or?
Not other than the fact that incentives already existed. And if we were looking to attract businesses, where these boundaries are, there are already incentives in place in this area right here that economic development has in place. We had considered from the beginning incentives for the arts district because they specifically pertain to artists, art groups, art organizations, but we needed to get one step at a time. We just want to get ahead of ourselves. And the suggestion that Dr. Whitaker made, we have definitely considered all of the museums, the Holiday House, and things like that, definitely a part of the cultural arts plan. On the website, it would be packaged all together. That way, anybody looking for that kind of information will find all of these different places, simply just because there are things that are.
Mayor Coutone.
Yeah, Mallory.
Yeah, because she said just a few words about the incentives.
Thank you, Mayor, Vice Mayor, and members of council. And we have worked together on this and been talking about the Enterprise Zone program that we have is well beyond these boundaries and would be available to not just the existing businesses and future businesses, but cultural arts businesses as well. And I think if I'm not taking words out of your mouth, the idea of any incentives that this group may bring back to you would be specific to just arts and cultural businesses versus the enterprise zone incentives that are tied to broader businesses but covers all this geography.
But it also, you're also in the historic district, so you got a couple of areas where you could potentially use to market
you
and bring someone in.
You can overlay the historic tax credit program. You can also overlay, some of this overlaps with the EDA's local incentive program, where we have some interior build-out and facade grants. So there are two or three, if not, if they also get another layer of incentives there, you'd be able to overlay those on these geographies.
So north to south doesn't hurt? We could do that?
No.
Okay.
No.
Good.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions or comments from Nation? Okay.
That's great.
Yep.
So is it okay for us to go on and work on a plan
absolutely.
Then? Okay.
Yep,
thank you so much.
Let me, Nancy, before you sit down, let me applaud you and your team for the exhibit over at the Portsmouth Community Library, the separate but equal.
Mm-hmm.
We had the grand opening, was it a couple of weeks ago?
Yes. Yes. Uh-huh.
We had a nice turnout, and I want to encourage everybody that hasn't been over there to go check it out. How close are we to getting Bailey's Barbershop and the General and Guide, and I thought we also were going to look at the black grocery store called Mutual.
The
right?
Mutual Drug Company.
The Mutual Drug
mm-hmm.
Company.
We hope that we'll have that ready by the end of August.
By the end of August.
We got some good responses at the opening with people looking at the big sandboard map. You enjoyed looking at
yes,
that.
Ma'am.
And so we've gotten some responses, people that have given us images and photographs and some stories that we can include to tell a richer story. So we should have that.
No, we plan to keep that exhibit up until...
The library side would be the permanent exhibit.
Okay.
The other side would be the changing exhibit uh-huh. side. And so the
every
first...
Every couple of months, maybe?
Probably every year, 18 months.
Okay.
So it would be the Black Business District on the Effingham corridor. We are also looking at... Ciceretta Jones mm-hmm. is an upcoming exhibit. The archivist from the Carnegie Hall was down to give a talk, and he's done a lot of research on Ciceretta Jones and has some things. So we're trying to work with Carnegie Hall to do an exhibit on Ciceretta Jones, probably, this is 2006, probably would open in late 2017, probably or beginning of 2018.
How about the Dr. Hugo Owens collection? Have you got anywhere with that yet? Or are you still working on it? Okay, yeah. I was the Library of Virginia has the Dr. Hugo Owens mm-hmm. collection, and upon his passing, the family had sent all of those items and artifacts to them, and they had a small display
mm-hmm.
from what I understood a while back, and we weren't notified.
Oh, okay.
It was up in Richmond, and I was curious
okay.
if we could contact the library and
sure.
see what they had, and if we could, because a lot of Dr. Owens' artifacts and things that he had originated in Portsmouth before he ended up in Chesapeake once it
mm-hmm.
was established
mm-hmm.
in 63 and all of those things. So that would be great while we were revolving that to see if we can't get the Hugo Owens piece there. So if
okay.
you could put that in your little...
Yeah, I wrote it down. I have it right here.
Any other questions or comments? All right, thank you. Good job.
Thank you so
yes,
much.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Mayor, we're going to go on with our second presentation, Mr. Daniel Jones, Director of Information Technology.
Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of the City Council, tonight I will present to you an overview of the Information Technology Department. Our mission statement is committed to administering a secure, reliable, collaborative, leading-edge, cost-effective, and supportive technology platform to all citizens, businesses, and departments. In January, we conducted an internal survey for professionalism, satisfaction, and timeliness relating to the information technology services we provide. Through the survey, we asked departments a series of 7 questions, and these results are before you. As you can see, the results reflect high scores across all the different sectors that we surveyed. Our areas of support include public safety, telecommunications, network infrastructure, cybersecurity, application management, help desk service, strategic planning and roadmap for our fiscal years 17 through 19, and a Wi-Fi deployment and naming. Our public safety support area provides 24/7 mission critical support of radio infrastructure for public safety needs, our 911 center infrastructure, mobile radio installations and programming. Our telecommunications division provides citywide wired and wireless communication infrastructure and provides 24/7 support of a 911 trunked phone system for the 911 center. Our network infrastructure supports a complex wide area network across the city, manages new or modified network implementations, manage and install all network appliances. Our cybersecurity handles the cybersecurity infrastructure upgrades, dedicated security professional monitoring, and an employee phishing implementation program. The applications management provides customer analysis support for commercial and custom written applications. The manage application modifications and functional requirements for all city revenue and tax billing systems. Provide database management for all the city applications. Our help desk service provides on-site or remote support for user issues, performs computer hardware support for city staff workstations, provides technical support for mobile devices, laptops, and other peripheral hardware. Now, our vision roadmap, this is a snapshot of what we see our vision for the next 3 years being, and it ranges from cloud deployment, application restructuring, centralized printing, mobile applications, Wi-Fi, fiber deployments, and security posturing. Now, this last slide that you see is, in May, Governor McAuliffe signed House Bill 912, which will allow companies to lay conduit along major highways to provide broadband access throughout the state. The governor and the Commonwealth of Virginia has launched a survey which searches out citizens that allows them to provide input as to whether they have current internet, they don't have current internet, the price is too high, speeds, business, companies, whatever it may be, and then they're going to pull all that information together and publish a report from there. The second one is a link that the city has put together as far as our Wi-Fi naming that will be available at all the municipal buildings. We would encourage citizens to suggest names. They would suggest names. We'll leave a survey open for approximately a month. Then after that point, we'll pull all the names together and come up with a citywide name for our Wi-Fi. And both of these links will be available on the main page of the city's website for citizens to click on. If you have any questions.
I'm not real computer savvy, so pardon my ignorance. The Wi-Fi we're talking about is in City Hall for employees to use or for citizens to use while they're sitting in a council meeting? Or who's using this Wi-Fi?
Okay. Currently, right now, it is in the deployment state. As you can see, the appliances are installed. We haven't got it completely configured at this point. It's right outside the door.
Okay, all right.
But once it's completely configured, both internal and citizens during meetings, they'll be able to use our guest Wi-Fi that we'll provide for them.
So we're talking about libraries and...
Well, libraries are connected, but City Hall, I'm not on Wi-Fi right now with my phone.
I am.
I'm not.
Okay. Is that just because I'm sitting closer to a device?
Right. There is one segment that is provided for this right here, but it's going to be a complete city hall-wide, and we're going to expand it to all the municipal buildings where citizens may go. They'll have access. That'll help us bridge the digital divide as well as
schools
the
hallway.
Schools
or
no? No, schools will be separate, but I think the schools, if I'm not mistaken, you will have to...
They have upgraded all of their schools with the notebooks that they just got. They did that prior to the students getting the notebooks.
Sure. Yeah. But I think they just done a whole Wi-Fi implementation across their high schools, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
Now, we had, at our last retreat with the PDC, we had a lengthy discussion with Virginia Beach and a couple other cities about that UWASI money that was drying up, and the beach and some of the others was talking about some type of bandwidth that we were supposed to get with here to see that we could use this region-wide instead of all of us doing our own thing here with IT as well as our 911 communication And did we ever look into that? Or we
and you can speak to that. Virginia Beach, Norfolk and Virginia Beach, they have the, they are just implementing.
Wasn't that the UWASA money, if I'm saying
I'm
that right?
Familiar.
I think it was UWASA, and I think the federal government is shrinking the money coming to Hampton Roads with that. But a couple of the cities had already put quite a bit of dollars in
Virginia
there.
Beach.
Because they talked about the gaps that they had in some of their 911 communication and some of the other things. And we were on the verge of spending $300,000 for phone networks and some other things that we probably need to look into.
I'm not aware of it, Mayor, but Chief, if you want to speak to it.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure this area was excluded from the UWASI funding. From
this area, mm-hmm. Portsmouth, or
the Hampton Roads area is no longer included in the UWASI funding.
Yeah, the money, right? The money has dried up, but we had a structure in place, and we've got some infrastructure in place in the beaches using. And I thought they said most of them and part of Norfolk were tied to it. Let's just look.
Yeah,
into
I do know.
Sure.
I do know that at our last, not the last, but about two CAO meetings ago, Virginia Beach had their information technology officer to make a presentation in regard to how they are. And I'm not computer, but what are they doing? They're doing this.
They are extending their own fiber ring throughout their city that will allow them to extend connections to their municipal buildings, potentially businesses, potentially even to residents, depending on how the business plan is.
And I think the thought process was us is if the federal government had dwindled the funding here, if we're all spending it in our budgets and doing our own thing, we should probably have something that was a little bit stronger. And if that infrastructure was in there, we need to look and see what we need to do to bring that and bring Portsmouth into the fold.
Mayor, we'll look at it because I connected Mr. Jones with the officer in Virginia Beach to get
Hansen
information on it.
Hansen went through a great discussion about just how much they had incorporated the beach and brought a lot of that all along the shoreline online with that, and it was something that was expandable to all of the cities, and I thought Norfolk already had a piece. Any other questions?
They do. Norfolk does have a piece, Mayor, at a cost of recent $4 million for them to tie.
Because if we had something like that and we all were in on it, then we wouldn't be, I mean, just our police communication system we're looking at overall.
Yeah.
We've broken it up into three or four different cycles, but we're talking close to a million. So, anyway, Dr. Water.
Yeah, Mr. Jones, are the public housing communities, do you know if they're Wi-Fi through the city or PRHA?
I do not know.
But
I can check on that too.
I do think, Dr. Whitaker, when we built Westbury, now left. We were building Westbury, and Westbury was supposed to be a Wi-Fi, and every development that PRHA is doing is supposed to have Wi-Fi capabilities.
But it's not through the city or PRHA?
No, that's PRHA, not through us. Federal funds.
Yeah.
Right.
Any other questions? Thank you, sir.
Okay. Our next presentation will be by Mr. Wright, our city engineer. Thank you, Mr.
Good evening, Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of the City Council, and I'm here to give you an update on 801 Water Street. City staff engaged Clark Nexon to provide a building assessment and to provide plans for the renovation at 801 Water Street to complete the relocation of the police department. They were to identify issues or repairs needed for the building, develop recommended repairs, and to provide an estimate of construction costs for those recommended repairs. As a background, Clark Nexon is one of our consulting firms that we have on annual services contract. They provide both structural engineering and A&E services under this contract. They're a full-service firm having expertise across multiple disciplines. Clark Nexon assessed the building in five major areas. They include life safety systems, building shell analysis, other critical systems, and in the interior finish assessment. Their assessment findings include significant water significant water infiltration similar to what we experienced here at City Hall. The solution to this problem involves curtain wall replacement, roof replacement, and exterior wall replacement. They also included replacement of the 100-ton chiller unit, replacement and relocation of the existing fire pump, generator, and associated electrical equipment. The cost for the renovation is on the slide before you. The cost of the repairs and recommendations from Clark Nexon is just over $6.5 million. The staff's recommendation for the move of the police into that building is $2.3 million for a rough cost of $9 million.
What else you
got?
We ain't doing that.
So, she's got to start it back up. He's got more. Is that your next spring?
No. Okay, so we examined several options for relocation, but the options that we initially looked at, they weren't cost effective or efficient. So we decided to shift our focus to 1801 Portsmouth Boulevard. At this location, you can provide a new facility to meet the needs of the police department. You'd have to demolish some of the existing buildings, do some site work, and to save some cost, you could use a pre-engineered Butler-type building that would save you both time and cost in the design and construction. And you also have the ability to co-locate the training facilities for the police department and the sheriff. There's approximately $1.2 million in the CIP for 801 Water Street. Those funds can be used at 1801 Portsmouth Boulevard to demolish those buildings and complete the planning and design in order to relocate the police department to that location. It's approximately the same amount of time if you use that pre-engineered Butler building that we had scheduled for the entire build out over those three fiscal years. Just in case you're not familiar with Butler building type construction, it's been used for over 60 years. It consists of frame, roof, and other structural components manufactured to specifications in a controlled environment. This type of construction cuts costs and saves time, as I mentioned before. Different types of building have used this type of construction, from agricultural to architectural, athletic and entertainment, community buildings, medical buildings, religious buildings, industrial and manufacturing buildings, government buildings, and also service and retail. The next couple of slides, I have some examples of Butler buildings. In the top frame, you have a fire station in Red Oak, North Carolina. It's just under 19,000 square feet. The bottom is the Newtown Youth Academy in Connecticut. It's just over 86,000 square feet, and it's used for community events and sports and recreation. To the left, you have the Landmark Conference Center in Fort Wayne, Indiana, just over 16,000 square feet. To the right at the top is a building at Kansas Wesleyan University that's just under 25,000 square feet that's used for community events and sports and recreation. And at the bottom, you have the Cape Fear Harley-Davidson that's just about 40,000 square feet.
I'm all for selling 801 Water Street, first of all. This $1.5 million certainly doesn't build a new building.
No, ma'am.
That's a demolition cost at Portsmouth Boulevard.
No. Explain what that includes.
The $1.2 million will get you some demolition of the building, but it'll also get you started for the planning and design to move towards
something that could include enough square footage for all of the police department.
Correct.
Just the police department, no sheriff, no fire.
Also the training.
That's to be determined, I guess.
What?
Including the Sally Port and what's required for detective bureaus and all those things that caught us over here.
Right.
That nobody talked about.
That's right. Now, Butler buildings can range in price from, what were some of the?
If you're looking at building a normal construction for a police building that would meet our needs, you're looking at anywhere from $8 million to up to $15 million. Butler buildings cuts that price in half.
A new Butler City, was it City Hall or in Salisbury, Maryland? I think it's Police Department.
Bowie, Maryland.
And
Bowie, Maryland. New City Hall and think of some public safety
and public
attached
safety.
To it. We had that conversation last Friday.
Yes. And that cost how much?
They were to get us the price of the city manager there. They were to get us a price. We don't have the price, but we know it is less than the $15 million if we the compared prices of us doing a construction and a Butler building, it's 50% less.
And you're going to save time as well.
And it has, you know, you would think, say, oh, well, they don't last long. It has longer longevity than what we did in the 70s.
What are you asking us to do tonight?
What we're just presenting. Right, that's it.
We need to have a serious conversation about the usage of that facility, what we want to do from the facility piece, and what's going to be a best fit for the entire city. If if we're talking about a public safety campus, it's going to be for everybody. We're not going to have anybody else somewhere else spending money somewhere. That's where we keep getting in trouble with. So if we're going to have that discussion, we need a Saturday morning where we vet and look at these other pieces like vocational education. We're looking at desperately needing to put a center somewhere, looking at all of our assets and making sure we do this in a collective and not isolated and just talking about 1801 or just talking about 801, looking at our whole portfolio, what we have before we even go down this road. But I appreciate the $9 million scare, and I'm sure that was the intent, but we're not going to do that either. But Mr. Chair?
I was just going to say, it's a long ways from turnkey $9 million.
That's right.
first thing.
Right.
But as we talk about these lines, you know, we have a lot of ideas and plans for the 1801 Portsmouth Boulevard anyway. And I'm sure there's enough property out there to do this.
Right.
But we need to make sure we are able to not only encompass but disconnect the uses, so to speak.
Yes.
So that there's no issue with recreation versus public safety. Because, you know, public safety got to fly, recreation got to play, you know, they got to do. So just make sure that that's all well laid out when you come back with whatever we come back with, whenever you come back with it, that we have, because I don't know if the entryways to that place right now will support doing what we got
to
do. We got to change all that, and we got to make sure it's probably segregated so that the uses don't overlap. We're not going to spend those $6 million on that. Matter of fact, we need to go ahead and sell that building tomorrow to whoever wants to buy it and get it off our books and move on. But that leads me to the you alluded to the putting everybody in one campus. Well, I'll wait to that. I won't go into that matter. But there are some questions about where we at with that now, because police were moving. Sheriff Department at that place with all the money we were spending, and so we need to backtrack and get all that together and make that one, as the mayor said, one whole piece when we make that step.
Vice Mayor?
There's a reason I'm going this way.
Okay.
There's a train of thought here. I would hope that we would agree to ask the manager and the clerk to come back or to think about a retreat for this council, which is going to have at least two new members come January 1st, to plan a retreat for like end of February, early March, you know, give those folks 60 days to get their feet wet. We haven't even had one since you've been on council. And we have got to have a time set aside to sit down and talk about these critical items. And I would hope that if you start planning now, you can at least get it on the books and find the right facilitator and place and all that good stuff.
That's a good idea. We need to do that, but we need to be laser focused on what we want. We're not going for happy talk. We're not going to eat chips and all that. We've got assets in this city, and they're spaced all over. And somehow, either staff, or somehow we get caught up in the buying something that's a sweet deal, and the minute we buy it, it turns into a lemon, and then that person leaves, and then everybody throws that guy under the bus, and there's $9 million to get it when that guy turnkey, we can do this, we can move everybody tomorrow, that type of stuff. So we have got to have a series, and I don't know if that's a retreat. I think that's more of a looking at our assets,
no,
everything
just made me
in
think
total.
That way.
Yeah, I understand.
Spend time.
But these assets that we have, the school assets that they have, how we best fit that, because we're going to need a Votech Center. Clearly, we're going to need one here. We're going to need co-locations of the police and sheriff and the fire and all of their specialties that they all list.
Gun
so,
range.
Right, so they're not together. We need all of that encompassed before we even make that decision, and you need to have some idea of their requirements and what they need before you get us involved. And because we need to have that. You need to have at least a baseline minimum of what is required.
Right.
Okay, not what they like, what is required and what the city is tasked with providing. And then we need to look at where those things regionally and if there are some opportunities to share things, because we don't need to be doing our own thing here when there are other places that we can go and contract to save dollars with. But we definitely need to have something like that. I am getting tired of all these assets popping up, and we can do this, and then all of a sudden it's another $10 million, which means we can't do that. And but that, again, the reason we got the piece on Portsmouth Boulevard is because we knew we didn't need it all, and we had 30 acres, and we could use those other acreage to do something with, whether it's a public safety campus or whatever. And so what best fits with it, we need Dr. Patton to have a dialogue of all of our assets on a map, where they are, what they're doing, even if we need to. And this may be something we could jointly do with the school board and their administration as to where they're going and what they're looking for, because you just can't allow these assets, like the DAC Center. That was a great idea, sounded great. We're almost
millions.
In year two, and we ain't done a damn thing.
Right, millions of dollars need to go into that.
And
right.
It's paid for.
Right.
And it's paid for. So, you know, and then we go and get a contractor that gives us $10 million to turn it into what we want, and then it makes it a bad deal.
Right.
Because somebody doesn't want to do that, so they want a $10 million figure to come and scale us. So, I mean, we all need to be in the middle of that and not have you guys coming and kind of steering council and throwing these numbers out, because we need it all collectively so we can make some intelligent decisions on how we want to move forward with all of this.
And I think they might, manager and stuff, they might have a handle on all the assets, but the trick is, we worry about hurting people's feelings. We got to do what's best for the city of Portland, and they can get over it,
or go
find
stuff
or do something else. But this is the burning question I got to ask. And where was Clark Nexon when this building was presented as turnkey?
May I speak, if I may? Vice Mayor, members of council, in my early months here, we were talking about this building, and you asked my engineer, my permits and inspection director, and our planning director, what was their involvement in the assessment of anything of this building.
They had none.
None of them had any involvement. You cannot take a building like that and I'm just going to go up and throw up some walls or tear down walls.
So we were paying this clock next to and we didn't and nobody
didn't
nobody
use them.
Used them?
No. No.
You don't. I mean, if I may, until you initiate a task order with them and ask them for services, you're not paying them anything.
But you had them on.
But yeah, we had them available, yes.
Yes.
Hey, what can I do with that?
Right.
So,
okay. We need that down the road.
Right.
And
90 days, 60 days, you want
yes,
to come
absolutely.
Back? Absolutely. All right, so we'll involve, you know, chief and whatever and do all homework. And
we'll
then
do your homework and get all
right,
the
we'll
minimum
come back.
Requirements.
Right.
Because,
right.
Again,
we will.
We just need the facts.
That's right.
That's all we're trying to get.
And
Now you guys starting to play politics too. Lead it with us.
Yeah.
You bring us.
Lead the politics to the politicians.
Don't tell us what everybody wants. Don't you go have side meetings with the sheriff and all these other people. We know what the state says we need to have, and I want to know what we have and how we can accommodate all that. Don't bring us anything that will wind up hurting your feelings, because then you'll get defensive because you got something in your idea of what you want. Bring us, like Paige said, the facts of what we need so we can make an educated decision and we're not jumping in and out with all of these different hot button projects. Fair enough?
That's what we'll do.
They've awakened us to be more alert and mindful of things that we discuss. We leave it alone for a while. And we know we have to do something about it, but it takes things like this to bring us back to reality. We need to get those things done.
Yeah, and we're shooting the messenger, but the messenger, right. the messenger didn't do it.
That's right.
It was a previous.
That's right.
Previous.
She brought back what we asked.
Right.
Right. Exactly.
So that's why we keep stressing the importance of not making this stuff specific to a manager or a staff member. This is the city of Portsmouth. The decisions we're making, irregardless of who is in these positions.
Yes.
That's what we need. That's what we're talking about.
All right, Mayor, I have one more thing. Yes, I'm going to ask our CFO to come up and call to your attention a piece on the retirement tax requirement.
Mr. Mayor, Vice Mayor, City Council members, wanted to talk to you about a resolution that we have an issue that we have coming to a resolution. Our city's retirement system.
Next meeting.
Our city's retirement system every 5 years was getting an IRS determination letter, basically stating that it was the IRS opinion that you're a qualified plan, you're tax exempt, and the determination letters are done every 5 years. In 2011, we got a conditional determination letter by the IRS saying that we had to update some of our city codes for tax law changes. Unfortunately, the city did not do that, and in January 2016, when we were doing the next determination letter, that was found out. We hired a pension tax law firm. They helped us draft some ordinance changes to our tax law. They have submitted those to the IRS the past week or so. And once the IRS reviews those, we'll be bringing them back to City Council for approval. And we just wanted you to be aware that that was happening and that will be coming in the next month or so.
And this is every 5 years?
Every 5 years. And actually, this is the last year we can do it. This IRS determination letters are going away, and the IRS is not going to qualify your plan. It's going to rely on the city or the retirement system sponsor to update their tax laws. And so we have put this tax firm on retainer, and once a year they're going to review the tax laws and tell us what we need to do to make sure that we update our code properly.
Okay.
Thank you.
When did the IRS notify the city that that ordinance needs to be?
2012.
When in 2012?
I don't know the exact date. We really couldn't find out. It was just 2011 and 2012 we got notified. But so we don't have the notification. It's not in the city attorney's office or anywhere. So when.
So how do you know it's a. How do you know it was 2011-2012?
Because when John Hancock, our actuary, our service that was helping us prepare the determination letter, they went back and found it. And so I could go back and look, and I didn't go back and look exactly what date it was.
And about how much is that liability going to be?
Actually, what we had to do is self-report, and we had to pay a $5,000 fine to the system. And so there's no liability. It's just we want to make sure we're in compliance with our tax laws.
Okay. And we were not.
Questions there?
Yes, sir. Is that a budget?
Well, you know, last week they delivered to us
the adopted
budget. Mm-hmm. And so while I had insomnia at 1 o'clock this morning, I just went through the.
I thought it was interesting beach reading.
I just went through the appendix. Yeah. Just the appendix. Let's look through the appendix.
Sure.
And these are probably simple, and they may be simple answers. You can just
sure.
Tell. Under the general fund, $250,000 for the sports auto thing. That's a state money.
That's state. Part of it is state. I'm sorry, how much did you say?
$250,000 under the in the general fund in section 100. That's the state $25,000.
That's in the revenue section, right. Yes, it is the state money.
Yeah, okay.
And it comes through and goes to them.
Under the human resource management, mm-hmm. We got a, looks like a $126,000 difference increase from the 2016 to 2017.
Where it's higher or lower? Or?
Higher. So it went from $469,000 to
$622,000. For HR human resources. Mm-hmm. I know we have
human resource management.
All right, a municipal internship is in there.
And probably the funding for the tuition reimbursement.
Tuition reimbursement, yes. To those two things probably make up the difference.
And these maybe I'll have good answers, but when I see increases,
that's a good question.
My ears prick up, so I want to make sure. Nanham Sports Hall of Fame and the non-departmental, there's $350,000.
Right, so, $250,000 is the revenue from the state and $100,000 from the city.
That's $100,000 that we're giving them. Right. That won't be there next year.
Right.
Okay.
And also in that, there's a new state law for that they're required to provide us financial statements.
Right, the ones that Dr. Whittaker asked for a year ago, and we're still waiting on.
Well, they are due by November 5th, as I reported to you all, or that money which the state has earmarked for them won't be coming through us.
Right. Now, I'm trying to remember the conversation we had about this on the transfer and contingencies for the parking authority. Transfer to parking authority, $590,000. What's the? If you don't know, we can talk about it later. I just want to. That's on the general fund, section 118-33.
Okay, I guess I didn't understand the question. Parking authority.
It says it's a transfer to parking authority, $590,179. For the FY 17 budget. I just don't remember that. I don't know what it is.
That's CIP projects.
Oh, CIP projects. That's what it is.
That's CIP projects?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then you got a $78,000 increase in the salary line for the clerk of the court. Is that state positions?
Yes, clerk of the court.
And a $75,000 increase in, just keep me up tonight if I don't get this. Juvenile and court services.
Some of this is the state-funded salary increases, which may or may not happen.
Yeah, because I remember us proving none of that. So if there's state money, I'm good.
Right.
It's the state money.
In the sheriff's line, contractor other, $64,000 increase. And then under the rental sheriff's training academy, we went from zero to $72,000. I don't know
that's the $72,000 that the sheriff found within his budget to cover the rent for his building.
And what's the contractor other for $64,000?
She would have to look at that.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know what.
Right. And Mr. Jerry, we'll be happy to sit down with you.
Okay. I
later tonight,
I was
if you like.
Today, but I didn't get a chance.
Yeah, I mean, we can sit down with her tonight. She has her book answer.
And I don't need that answer now. Just so tomorrow's fine.
Okay.
We got the same thing. We got a contractor other increase of $112,000 in the police department as well. I'm sure it's totally legitimate, but
That one I do know. We did fund some video storage for body cameras.
Well, that's the 100 and for the body cameras that we did.
There was one other thing though that we audio surveillance.
Yeah. In again.
Mm-hmm.
Eagle eye.
Okay. That's it.
Okay.
Those things.
We had very, very few increases.
Yeah.
So you got all of them, actually.
It was a grant, and it's no more grant.
You said there were more increases?
I said there was very few increases, and I think you mentioned all of them.
Okay.
So,
right.
Thank you.
So I'll need to look at this in tonight. I can only do this again tonight, right?
Sure.
I'm good for tonight.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you.
This concludes the presentation to Mayor Vice Chairman.
Okay, we've got a motion to go into close, but prior to, are there any liaison reports or anything anybody else need to discuss before we do that? Okay, anything, and you get any items in open that we need to
Dr. Whitaker asked for an update on status in terms of GPDC. I can just give him a brief update on. From the documents that we have obtained, this is just a cursory view of the documents we've obtained that are executed. GPDC, the registered agent and incorporator, is David Tench. It was organized in 1998. At last report from the documents I have, it has six parcels of land, the value of which is $3,837,183, with liabilities of $1,934,821. With regard to the Holiday Inn property, there was a 2008 contract agreement between the city and GPDC that reflected a payment of approximately $7 million to retire GPDC debt, where GPDC would continue to develop the property or assist in the development of property and keep the city manager and the city attorney informed, and no sale of that Holiday Inn property would occur unless city council received approval.
Who made the payment?
The original payment.
We did.
One payment was made by GPDC, and then there was a the city also made a payment to PRHA to replace that debt.
How much were the two payments?
The two are $7 million.
No, how much was the one the city made?
$7 million.
Okay. What was this? You said there were two payments. The one the city made was made to who?
PRHA.
And then you said it was a second payment?
The original $7 million was covered by GPDC.
Well, GPDC is the one-third of that is the city.
That's what it is.
One-third is the city.
Correct.
One-third is Portsmouth Partnership, and one-third is PRHA.
Correct.
So if a payment was made by GPDC, how is it not the city involved?
They were both involved, and I can certainly come back, and I will come back and add some more detail to this. I just wanted to tell you what those documents are we have and what they reflect in terms of those recitals.
And the figure you gave earlier, you said that the property is presently, six properties are valued at $3.8 million.
Correct.
And it's a $1 million.
$1.9
million debt.
Right.
So what was the debt prior to the $7 million? That you have on
I don't have the historical. I have a snapshot as of today. We don't have the historical. Okay. I'm reporting from what we have today. Some of the documents are historical. That report is from a 2014 filing.
Okay.
And so that's a snapshot as of today. There was also, and I think some folks have mentioned before, the 2012 demolition agreement between GPDC, the city, and PRHA, wherein GPDC obtained a line of credit of approximately $1 million to refinance debt for the demolition of the hotel. The agreement was to refinance an original loan, I believe that was with BB&T, and the debt payments would be paid a third by each organization, the city, GPDC, and PRHA, and when this sale of the property.
That's what's confusing. You keep saying the city, and I'm not saying
sure.
What's confusing. You keep saying the city, PRHA, and GPDC, when GPDC
is all of
is the city, PRHA, and Portsmouth Partnership. And I keep hearing all of this debt accumulation, but I don't hear Portsmouth Partnership as one of those who have some
paying in
contribution
it. No skin
in this.
Game.
But yet there's some profit that's going to come to them. That's what's good. You're saying GPDC, city, and PRHA. I don't hear the third party.
And Dr. Whitaker, as I said before, what I'm reflecting to you today is what the documents are. I certainly understand the question.
Right. So the documents are reflecting that these agreements are between GPDC, the city, and PRHA.
Correct.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. That's correct.
Mm-hmm. And what present activity is going on with GPDC as far as receiving rent and city payments?
I understand that there are payments being made with regard to the Holiday Inn property to address the current debt. I understand that there have been service payments, but we don't have those documents as of yet in terms of what the past payments have been. But there have been discussions with the city in terms of trying to account for those and move forward with a means of dissolving or wrapping up all of those processes in those parcels.
I don't see how you can dissolve it until we're clear on the money trail.
I don't disagree with you, Doctor, and we certainly will be coming back. That's why I just wanted you asked me to give you a reflection of where we are today. We certainly have to come back to you with some additional information to fill in some gaps. I just wanted to, you asked specifically about the Holiday Inn property, and I wanted to give you those two snapshots in terms of what is going on with that, and we will come back with further detail in terms of what is in between those processes to the extent that we can find those and get some more folks to speak directly to that process and then give you some guidance going forward.
Okay. PRHA gave us a lot of information at the last meeting from their legal persons that they had doing some research on this. And I think it would be good if you would see that. I have it. I have a copy of it. I think Councilman Whitaker has a copy of it, too.
Is everything this? From all three entities and see documentation and how much skin we all got in the game.
Well, there's a paper trail. We have paper stacks that much.
All three entities?
Yes.
Okay. That's what we need because...
What PRHA gave was...
Their
documentation is showing it. What I was curious as to the documentation
to
that
out.
The city has, particularly
our records of what our expenses were and how much of this we paid in. We know about the $7 million that we did, and that was put into the EDA fund to kick over to them back in 7-8 years ago, and then the $1 million that we gave them for the demolition piece. But that's all coming out of the city. So if we're a third. So if we gave $1 million, two other people should have gave $1 million, okay? And if the other two didn't put $1 million in, then we're not three equal parts. And so when you start talking about dissolving, you can't dissolve if we're the only ones put the money in. If I got $7 million in that Holiday Inn site and nobody else does,
right?
Well, when we dissolve, they're not getting a dime out of it, right? And I
certainly understand the issue, ma'am.
Right. Also, do we have any documentation that the $7 million went to PRHA?
I would have to coordinate with the city to see what actual paper trail.
Okay.
I'm speaking through the recitals and the agreements that were executed. I would have to check over another department.
Documentation so we can attach to all of that as well. Because I think when I researched that a while back, the records show that it was put in the budget that year, and it was put on a category called EDA or IDA, $7 million. And what EDA and IDA did to get that money over to PRHA or GPDC or whoever the $7 million covered, and then the same trail with the $1 million for the demolition of that piece. And these other current properties here, because I think there's a move to get all of this stuff together and make sure we know what these assets and liabilities are and who owns them, and then again, who's got how much skin in the game.
And the reason I was asking about what's happening presently is because Dr. Patton, you're listed as through the State Corporation Commission for GPDC.
And whoever put my name on there, you all appointed me to four places. Right. I checked with Mrs. White to get the four appointments that this council has made of me. This council has not made me appointed to any other body. My name may be wherever it is, but I didn't put my name there, and I need legal to start looking at who put my name there, because you appointed me to four,
right,
and the clerk validated. So you announced to me in the meeting last 2 weeks ago, Dr. Patton, you the treasurer, and I just was quiet.
Secretary treasurer,
and I just was quiet. I was about to say, Mr.
That's why I think we need to get those.
That's why I was
curious what is currently going on, because
yes, I'm not the treasurer.
If you're not involved in it,
no,
then
I'm not.
Who's making these decisions on
behalf
of the
no
city?
I have no idea.
Who's
I'm
looking
not.
Out for the interests of the city?
No, you all didn't appoint me there.
Right. Okay. Yeah, let's do that. We're talking about thorough. We're talking about backup data to prove each one of these transactions from the city side, because
sure.
I think PRHA is doing the same thing, and hopefully the other entity is, but we need to make sure what we dispersed and where that money went and how it got there.
I need you.
Okay.
And Mr. Ashby, I'll bring you my information that I have. It might shed some light, might keep you more baffled.
I would suggest that it come through the PRHA legal counsel, that it be communicated through the legal counsel. PRHA legal counsel.
I'll reach out to PRHA.
I'll save my PRHA question until we go out there, since we're running out of time.
Yeah, okay.
And there is the next PRHA meeting third Thursday of this month.
Right.
There will be an update on this whole GPDC issue as well.
Very good. Anybody else? All right, someone check us in the close. Since you're up reading all night.
Thank you, Mayor. I move to go into closed meeting pursuant to Virginia Code Subsection 2.2-3711A.7 for the purpose of consultation with legal counsel pertaining to the actual or probable litigation, where such consultation in the open meeting would adversely affect the negotiating or litigating posture of the city, specifically regarding the City of Portsmouth versus the South Norfolk Jordan Bridge LLC, filed in the Portsmouth Circuit Court as case number CL15002064-00N01, and pursuant to Virginia Code Subsection 2.2-3711A.19, for the purpose of discussion, reports, and plans related to the security of facilities, buildings, and structures within the City of Portsmouth, and the safety of persons using such facilities, buildings, and structures over the next 30 days, and pursuant to Virginia Code Subsection 2.2-3711A1, for the purpose of discussing and considering prospective candidates for appointments to boards and commissions, and pursuant to Virginia Code Subsection 2.2-3711A7, for the purpose of consultation with legal counsel employed or retained by the public body regarding specific legal matters requiring the provision of legal advice, specifically regarding the Portsmouth Redevelopment Housing Authority, and pursuant to Virginia Code Subsection 2.2-3711A7, for the purpose of consultation with legal counsel employed by or retained by a public body regarding specific legal matters requiring the provisions of legal service specifically related to claims or potential claims by Virginia Retirement System against the City of Portsmouth.
All right. Hold on, is that a second?
Second.
Yep. Okay, Madam Clerk, you want to call the roll?
Mr. Cherry?
Yes.
Dr. Edmonds?
Yes.
Mr. Meeks is absent. Mr. Moody's absent. Mrs. Edmonds has stepped out. Dr. Whitaker?
Yes.
Mayor Wright?
Yes.
We are in close. Thank you.